nobody here that didn't perform at least once in his career, okay, this kind of measurement. So how actually we do these measurements? As I said before, okay, pH measurement is actually a potential static measurement in which we have to have a sensing electrode and a reference electrode, remember? Okay? Our sensing electrode should be, in this case, an electrode that is sensitive to variations in proton concentration. Right? Is that clear? Okay, this is our sensing electrode. Now, today, the most common pH sensing electrode is what we call the glass electrode. Okay, why it is called the glass electrode? Because you can imagine this tube that we have here. On the tip of this tube, we have a special glass that was initially invented by a company by the name Corning, of Corning, that probably you are familiar with. It's a US-based company, okay, very famous in its glass expertise. And the glass that we have today that is sensitive to proton concentration has this composition, okay, that is written here, and it is being put on the tip of this tube that this tube is made out of a standard glass, okay? So, as I said, for different reasons, this glass, this typical glass that is marked here in green, okay, is selective to protons in the sense that just protons can go through this glass back and forth, okay? So, if we have in the internal part of this tube, if we have a silver wire that again is coated by silver chloride, okay? And we have an internal solution that contains hydrogen chloride at a concentration, exact concentration of 0.1 molar, okay? This will form the reference solution that we are using, okay? So usually, if you will look at a glass electrode that you have in the laboratory, you don't have any access to the internal part of this glass electrode, okay? It is totally sealed, okay? You do have access to another part of the electrode that we shall talk in a minute, okay? Because we always refer not just to the glass electrode, but to the combined glass electrode, okay? I'll show you what is under the term combined, okay? But to this part of the glass electrode, it is totally sealed. We do not have any access because this serves us to us as a reference solution, okay? A reference solution. Now, this is being dipped in the solution in which we want to sense the pH. Okay, of course, I don't have to tell you that the concentration of protons can be easily translated into pH terms, okay? This goes without saying. But what happens here is that when we dip this glass electrode in a solution that contains, for instance, 0.001 molar of protons, okay, which means pH 3, okay, pH 3. What happens is, because this tip is selective to protons, okay, potential difference will be built across the membrane, this will be developed across the membrane, okay, and this potential difference we are going to measure, okay. Now, so this is one part, this is the sensing part of the glass electrode, okay, which is the, which is essential, otherwise we will not be able to measure pH. And this is the Nernst equation that is associated with this electrode. So we have the Nernst equation that is associated with the potential of the external solution, okay? This is the solution that we have out of this glass part, okay? And because of this, we have here C external, okay? And on the other hand, we have the potential that is associated with the internal part of the of this electrode, okay, this sensing electrode, which I mentioned that C internal, usually it's 0.1 molar, okay, so we can replace this with a 0.1 molar, but I want still to make it general, okay. So we have these two Nernst equation. In equilibrium, the potential difference that is being developed across the membrane, okay, across the membrane, the selective glass is this, this is delta G, delta E glass, delta E glass, which is the difference between these two potentials, and we get this kind of expression for this purpose, and you can see that here we have just C external. Where's the C internal? Where? Where did it disappear? Where? In the K, exactly. Very nice. Okay? Excellent. Since this is a constant, I mentioned, we do not change, okay, the internal concentration, we can make it as part of the K. K is a constant, okay? Now, K, and you have it here. Okay? You can see it here. Right? Now, K doesn't change, allegedly. Okay? But in reality, it may change due to different factors, not because of the concentration, because the concentration is fixed. Okay? Different factors, for instance, temperature. For instance, some changes may occur to the glass, the selective glass itself, okay? And maybe there are many other reasons why K may change, okay? Why K may change. That is the exact reason why we need to calibrate, exactly, okay? You remember, before you start measuring the pH, you have to do some calibration, okay? It's essential that you do calibration, otherwise we are not sure that we'll get the right values of the pH. Is that clear? Okay? That is exactly this K that may be changed, okay, due to different reasons, that's exactly the reason why we have to do the calibration every time when we start, before we start measuring the pH. Okay? So, as we mentioned before, we have to do, there should be two in order for having a nice dance, okay? And here, in this case, the two are the reference electrode and the sensing electrode, okay? So in order to make the, to perform the measurement, we have to have also, in addition to the sensing electrode, a reference electrode. And here you have the glass electrode itself, okay, that I mentioned before, dipped in the same solution as the reference electrode. And the reference electrode can be either silver-silver chloride or calomel electrode. Usually today, it's a silver-silver chloride electrode, okay? Today, we combine these two electrodes into one electrode, right? Which we call combined glass electrode. Combined glass electrode is because we have both the sensing and the reference electrode in the same setup. Okay, this is the combined glass electrode. It's quite complicated, but if you look carefully, maybe I have another more closer. I think it, here it's better to look at it. This is a combined glass electrode, okay, which has both reference and the sensing electrode. And you can see, this is the glass electrode itself, okay, the pH electrode, which is totally sealed. Okay? It has the reference electrode here, which is separated internally, totally separated from the glass electrode itself. We have here a solution in the surrounding into which the silver-silver chloride is dipped in. Okay? Right? You can see it. And we have the same porous plug as we had before, as I showed you before, we have it here. You see, this is a, number seven is the porous plug, okay? Which is aimed at allowing the electrical connection between the reference electrode and the solution. And the other electrical connection is provided by the glass electrode. Okay, so this is the combined glass electrode, and we measure the potential difference between, even though there is just one wire, it probably should be double wire, because one wire comes from here, from the reference electrode, the other wire comes from the glass electrode. Okay, so we measure the potential difference that is being developed between the two electrodes, right, due to the concentration of protons in the solution. Okay, so this is the combined glass electrode. You can see, okay, this is a photograph, actually, of a real glass electrode. I don't know who is the manufacturer, but you can see the glass membrane on the tip, okay? And you can see the silver-silver chloride of the glass electrode part, and you can see also the reference electrode here, okay? And here, it's very difficult to see it, but you have here the porous plug, okay? Again, the same rules that we had about each one of these reference electrodes that I mentioned, okay, we have also here. But here, we have to be much more careful. First of all, we have to be careful not for the electrode not to touch the bottom of the beaker, okay, because otherwise there's a good chance that it will break. And we wouldn't like to have it because these electrodes are pretty expensive, okay? And I'm sure that it happens more than one time to you, okay? So today, the modern electrodes have a protective cover, okay, that prevents the electrode from touching the bottom of the beaker, okay? And we have to, when we are not using it, we have to keep dipping it in the solution that is the solution of the actually the solution of the reference electrode, whether it's saturated KCl or trimolar KCl, depending on the recommendation of the manufacturer. Okay, so everything should be kept wet. Otherwise, the pulse plug will be plugged, and some changes may occur to the glass. Okay, so we have to be very careful about this. Okay, any questions? Yeah. You can answer by yourself what is the benefit of using combined glass electrode. It's much more convenient. Instead of dipping two electrodes, you have to dip just one electrode, which contains actually two electrodes. Okay? Is that the answer to your question, or you meant something else? Yeah, this is the combined glass electrode, yeah, in which you have both reference and the glass electrode itself, okay? This is the combined. Today, it's very rare to find just the glass electrode, okay? You usually buy the combined glass electrode because it's much more convenient to use it, right? Any other questions? Slide number 12. Ah, which one? I don't see the numbers. This one? Ah, previous one? This one? This one? Okay. Yes. Yes. Yeah, yeah. Kg is a constant, okay? Which I, when I combined this one, this expression with Kg, we got K, okay? Because we can do it because actually this expression is constant because the concentration here, the internal concentration is fixed. You cannot change it, okay? So this is constant too. So it's more convenient to combine these two a constant. Okay? Excuse me? I don't understand the question. Yes, yes. Yeah, okay, but it is in because, yeah, that's a good question. Okay, right, I see what you mean. That's a good question. Okay, I had to say it before. When we subtract the two equations, okay, we don't actually get the K. Okay, but the K is there because of these different changes. Okay, that may occur to the glass electrode, and because of this, this delta EG may change. Okay, so this is a correction factor that is there because we have to correct it from time to time. Okay, yeah, it's a good question, good remark, right? Okay, any other questions? Okay, if not, let's go on. Uh, Okay. By the way, this is a photograph of the internal structure of silver chloride electrode. So you see, you remember that I mentioned that there is in addition to the silver wire and the solution, the manufacturers put a precipitate of silver chloride there, a mass precipitation of silver chloride, in order to be sure that equilibrium is maintained. Okay. And you can see it here. You can see also, not very clearly, the porous glass, the porous tip here. Okay? Okay, it is not that clear, but it is there. Right. Now, you know that pH, we have a certain range where we can measure the pH values with these glass electrodes. Okay? And the range is usually, you can see here, this is the potential difference that we measure. I don't know exactly versus what was the, what is here, in this case, specific case, what is the reference electrode, but it doesn't matter for the sake of our discussion, as a function of the pH. And you can see that the graph is pretty linear, somewhere between, I would say, let's do it safely, between 0 pH and pH 11, okay? Usually, we say that it's more safe to measure pH, okay, in the range of, let's say, 1 to 11, okay? We wouldn't like to measure pH around 0 because it's still not that not that accurate, okay? Right? So this is the range, more or less, that we can measure safely pH in our solutions. Okay? Okay. We are talking about sensing. So, yeah. By pH?
Strip. pH strip.
Strip? What do you mean pH strip?
By changing the color. Ah,
okay. This is another, it contains, you know, there are several, there's a large collection of what we call indicators that change their colors at different pH values, okay? So these sticks are soaked with different indicators, and when each indicator is for different pH range, and when you dip these sticks into the solution, colors change, and according to the color, you can estimate. You are not going to measure exactly the pH, but you can estimate what is the pH range that you have. Okay? So this is a totally different way, not to measure, but to estimate the pH. Okay? Other questions? Okay, let's go on. We are still talking about sensing, okay? And the same as we had for the pH, which is a selective electrode for pH, we have selective electrodes for other different applications. For instance, we have selective a whole bunch of electrodes, a whole collection of electrodes for in order to sense specifically ionic concentrations in solutions, okay? And each one of these electrodes is built differently, but in the sense that the sensing part of these electrodes is adapted to the specific ion that we would like to sense, okay? Otherwise, it's exactly, the principle is exactly the same. We have here, okay, we have here a specific membrane like we had with the pH electrode, okay? Which in this case, you see, in this case, it senses fluoride, okay? Because this is a membrane of lanthanum fluoride, okay? Which is selective to fluoride ions. So we can measure selectively fluoride ions in the solution, okay? Which you correctly say that in this case, the internal solution should contain what? Should contain what? Of fluoride, yeah. A solution of fixed concentration of fluoride, okay? So it's the same principle as we had with the pH, other than the membrane here, this is the sensing element, is different and, as I said, specifically adapted to the ion that we want to measure. Right? Okay? And of course, now it goes without saying that we have to have, in order to be able to measure, we have to have the reference electrode. Okay? Right? I will not go on the entire range. Just I want to show you that there are different manufacturers today that have developed different electrodes. I have a list of. Let me see, where is this? Maybe it's in the end. Okay, it's yeah, it's very difficult to see it. Let me see. No, it's not here. Yeah, more or less. This is not what I meant. I remember that I had a table of reference electrodes, but this is, you can see, this is a collection of reference electrodes. That from one of the manufacturers. It's very difficult to see it, but here, for instance, this electrode is for nitrates. Okay, the other electrodes, let me see, this is for fluoride. Okay, the other electrodes are difficult for me to observe. Okay, so but we have if you look, for instance, at the catalog of a company like Radiometer, okay, like Fluke, okay, you will see that they have a very large collection of these kind of electrodes. One very important point. These electrodes sometimes may be very, very sensitive to contaminations, okay? So we have to keep them clean. Not to mention that likewise, what we had with the pH electrode, we have with each one of these electrodes, we have to standardize them, okay? Which means we have to calibrate them, okay? So we have standard solutions, okay? And each time before we start, we have to calibrate them. So we will know that we are measuring the real number or the real figure that we have in our solution, okay? It's very tricky, usually, because many other, usually when we measure, especially in the industry, not to mention if you are dealing with wastewater or with seawater or with brackish water, or any kind of water that contains not just the single ion that you would like to measure, but many other ions, a large collection of other ions, okay? I'm saying it very surely, they will interfere in your measurements, okay? So usually what you have to do is to use what we call the standard addition calibration. You know what is the standard addition calibration? No? You take the same water that you would like to measure, okay? And you add a precisely known concentrations of this ion that you would like to monitor. Okay? You use three, four, five concentrations, different concentrations, and you measure the potential difference, okay? And then you draw a line that will describe the reading as a function of the concentration that you added. Okay? Then you are sure that you did the calibration taking into account the interference of the other ions that you have in the solution. Right? This is the best way to do, not to use the standard solutions that are being provided by the manufacturer, because this is done for the purpose of some very definite solutions, okay? But if you have very complex solutions, this is the best way to do it. Right? Is that clear? Okay. Did you have a question? No? Okay, is that clear? This is a very important point. And also, as I mentioned before, to keep them clean, there are several ways that recommendations by the manufacturers how to keep these electrodes, and when something happens, when they are getting contaminated, how to clean them. Okay? Right? Okay, so these are the reference electrodes. Similarly, we can measure gases that are dissolved in the solution. Okay, they have to be dissolved in the solution. Gases like carbon dioxide. We are still in the potential static measurements. Okay, I remind you, we can measure CO2, we can measure ammonia, we can measure H2O, H2S. Okay, we can also measure oxygen. I'll talk about it in a couple of minutes. This is a different method. This is the galvanostatic method that we mentioned before, okay? Not the potential static method. So just keep in mind that there are ways also to measure potential statically the some of the dissolved gases too. Okay? Here you have an example of a carbon dioxide sensor. Okay, here you have the reference electrode, AGAGCL electrode. Okay, you have a special gas permeable membrane which brings the carbon dioxide, in this case, into this chamber, and this electrode, the iridium oxide electrode, is an electrode that is specific for carbon dioxide. Okay, it interacts reversibly with the carbon dioxide in some manner, by this way we can sense the amount of carbon dioxide in the solution. Okay. We are now shifting to the second way of measuring of electrochemical measurements, and this is, in this case, these are the galvanostatic measurements. Right? Remember, in the galvanostatic measurements, we measure the current rather than the potential difference. Okay, the current that is passed through the measuring cell due to an electrochemical reaction that we induce by means of an external power supply. Before going into this, do you have any questions regarding to what we said so far? Any questions? Everything is clear. Right. Okay. Electrochemical oxygen sensor. Electrochemical oxygen sensor, let me see if I have a much better. No. Contains, electrochemical oxygen sensor contains two electrodes. Here you can see, here the structure of the cell. Okay, we inject the oxygen. The oxygen may come in two forms. Okay, whether it's a gaseous oxygen or it's an oxygen that is dissolved in a solution, depending on which. The structure of this kind of cells will be changed. Okay, in the oxygen electrodes that we use in order to monitor dissolved oxygen, okay, we have to provide the undisturbed contact between the electrode itself, the internal part of the electrodes, and the solution. In which we measure the dissolved oxygen concentration. Okay? In this kind of cells, where we measure gaseous oxygen, the solution that we have inside is being in touch with the gaseous oxygen that we would like to measure. Okay? And the oxygen becomes in equilibrium with the solution, it dissolves. In the solution, and we measure the current. I'll talk about it in a couple of minutes. Why I'm saying this? Because, for instance, I'll show you. Let me show you now. Okay, these two electron sensors, oxygen sensors, are coming from the car industry. Today, each one of these of our cars, the modern cars, okay, have what we call oxygen sensor. Built in the internal combustion system, okay, and this is to optimize the amount of air that is being injected into the combustion chamber, okay. So it is being done constantly. The principle of measuring in the car system of the principle of measuring the gaseous oxygen that is injected into the engine, the car engine, is exactly the same as when we measure dissolved oxygen. Okay, it's exactly the same. This is the galvanostatic measurement that we are doing. Okay, but the internal, the structure of the cell is different. Okay, as I said. So you can see these are robust oxygen sensors, this and this. This, for instance, comes from the Volvo company. Okay, this one, let me see. No, it doesn't mention here. The manufacturer is Clark Technology, but. It doesn't mention to which car, in which car it is being used. Okay. Anyhow, you see how robust they are. Okay, and they are being plugged directly into the engine, the combustion chamber of the engine. So let's get back. So we have this chamber, which contains two electrodes. This is the this is the anode, and this is the cathode, and we apply a certain voltage across the across these electrodes, and we measure the current that is being generated as a result of oxygen, dissolved oxygen, okay, that you have here. Okay, this is the reaction the current of which we monitor in this kind of reaction, these kind of reactors. Okay, and of course, it is the current is dependent on the concentration of oxygen. Right? Is that clear? Is that clear? Okay. The anode here, in this case, this specific case, the anodes are being made of lead, as you can see here. Okay, so this, by the way, this happens. This reaction happens on the cathode. Okay, I didn't mention it before. I should have mentioned it. This happens on the cathode, and on the anode, which is made of lead, we get this reaction. Okay, so we have a closed loop of current that we can measure. Okay, and this reaction on the anode is actually reversible. Okay, and as it says here, it can be either lead or zinc. It doesn't matter right now. It depends again on the manufacturer. Okay. So this is the electrochemical oxygen sensor, and it is now being used widely, either in our labs, especially, you know, if you treat wastewater, okay, in an anaerobic or aerobic manner, okay, you have to know the concentration of oxygen that you have in your reactor. Okay, especially when you deal with anaerobic systems, and you want to be sure how anaerobic is the system. Okay, so it is very important to constantly monitor the amount of dissolved oxygen in our water that we treat. Okay, not, and again, it is also important today in the car industry and in many other applications. Okay, any questions? Is that clear? Yes.
I have a question regarding the measurement of the ion.
Measuring?
Of any ion, like using this kind of electrodes.
The ion specific electrodes?
Ion selective electrodes, not specifically in ions. Like for measuring, while we are heating inside the reactor, the liquid should be in a mixing situation or in static situation.
Yeah, right. Yeah, that's a good question. I would say that it is much better to stir the solution, okay, but not that vigorously. Okay, why? Because sometimes you will find that because of the stirring, there may be some interruptions, okay, and some deviations in the measurement, okay, because of air bubbles that are coming, because of some added potential, although very small, that can, because of the movement of the solution, can occur on the specific membrane that is being used in these electrodes. Okay, so, but you need this steering in order to maintain the constant concentration of the ions of that you have in the solution in the vicinity of the electrode. Okay, because usually some concentration gradient may occur near the electrode. Right? So you would like to avoid it. So I would say the answer, like always, is something in between. Okay? You have to have the mixing, but not that vigorously.
Why is the measurement, shall I put for mixing? Or normally, if it is in mixing condition, I have to switch it off, and then I'm putting, dipping my electrode and measuring it. Then I can get the stable value nicely.
Okay, so it depends on the system. Okay, so It depends on the system and, yes, upon your own experience with your specific system. Yeah, you have to, like always, you have to learn the behavior of your system before you start getting into conclusions, okay? So, yeah, you have to be very careful with this. If you find out that there are large differences between the measurements, sometimes it's preferable to do it with a quiescent solution. Yeah, I agree. Not necessarily. So that's why I'm saying you have to experience first, okay, the measurements before getting into any conclusion, okay? There's no definite answer for that, I'm sorry. sometimes we have to you know, use our own judgment, you know, our own judgment or own experience, you know. But you see, if you do the calibration under exactly the same conditions that you do the measurements, that's also a way to overcome these kind of issues. Okay? So then you know that you take into consideration all the other interferences that may occur while measuring these ions, for instance. Right? So maybe this is the best way to cope with it. Yeah, any other questions? Okay. Okay. Likewise, we had the ion selective electrodes, okay? That I mentioned that most of them have, all of them actually, have specific elements, specific, in most of the cases, in the form of membranes, okay, specific membranes. Sometimes, today, we can find in the market electrodes that are based on membranes that contain enzymes. Okay, we know very well that enzymes may be specific to different components that we would like to sense in the solution. Okay, and the components may be either, I would say, polymeric components or simple ions. Okay, it depends. And here we have a very large variety that now the manufacturers come out with to the market. So these are what we call the enzyme-based sensors that are functioning exactly the same as the unselective electrodes that I mentioned, but their internal structure is again specific to the component that we would like to measure, okay? And because these membranes contain enzymes which may be extremely sensitive, okay, to many contaminations that can that we can find in solutions, it's very tricky to use these kind of electrodes, okay? We have to be very careful. And usually, you know, it's very difficult to do these kind of measurements. Not to mention that we have to replace these membranes after each measurement, okay, which makes these measurements extremely expensive. Okay, so we can use these kind of electrodes, but not that often. Just for specific applications that we don't have any other way to do. So again, I will not get into too much details on this, but just for you to know that we have these kind of electrodes. For instance, in this case, okay, we have this is a system in for measuring urea in water or in blood. Okay, so we have this enzyme, specific enzyme, which is called urease. Okay, what I have to say is that this kind of electrodes are being used today widely, especially in medical examinations. Okay, for instance, in measuring the level of glucose in blood. Okay, this measurement is based on this kind of membranes. Okay, and it is being used. This is based on electrochemical potentiostatic, okay, not galvanostatic, potentiostatic measurements, right? So we have to be aware that these kind of measurements are there in the market. Any questions? Yes. Okay, let me explain it again. Let's take take a look again on this reaction. Okay, when we apply potential, we induce this reaction on the cathode. Okay, but and you can see that on the cathode we actually supply electrons to water and to oxygen in order to reduce, okay, the oxygen. Now, the amount of electrons that we have to supply, okay, is directly proportional to the concentration of the oxygen. Okay, so of course, you have to calibrate it before. Okay, I didn't mention it, but it goes without saying. Like in every other device, okay, here too, we have to calibrate it in order to exactly know during the measurement the level of the oxygen. Okay? So this is the answer actually. Okay? Current is proportional to the concentration through the Faraday number, of course. Okay? Right? No. This is not the case. Let's assume the system is in equilibrium, okay? Which means that the amount of oxygen doesn't change in your system, okay? So then, it's enough to dip the electrode. The system in your solution, okay? And to turn on the device, and everything is done automatically. I mean, the right voltage is being applied across the electrodes, and the current is measured. And usually, you get directly from the current, since it's already calibrated, okay, you get directly the current transferred into, converted into in terms of oxygen concentration. Okay, so this is done in the device itself. Okay, so you don't have to have to worry about how to do it. Okay? Is that clear? Yeah, okay, so because you know you have to measure a certain you have to measure a certain amount of coulombs in order to overcome the sensitivity of the system of the device, okay, because each device has a has its own sensitivity for measuring, you know. So I guess that if the concentration level of oxygen is very low, it will take much more time to measure it, okay? Because you have to, how to say it, to gather the information in order for the measurement to be reliable, okay? Right? The devices, the oxygen sensor, the sensors that we have usually contain just two electrodes, okay, which are dipped into your solution, and they use your solution with the oxygen dissolved in this, okay, for this kind of measurement. Okay, the other electrodes that are used for measuring gaseous oxygen are a little bit more complicated because they have to have their internal solution into which we inject the gaseous oxygen or the mixture in which we have the oxygen. Okay? Right? Any other questions? Yes.
Sir, can we revive the reference electrodes which have lost less sensitivity or which are showing reduced?
I don't understand it. What?
Suppose there is a DGCL electrode which is showing depletion.
Yes.
After continuous use. So
yes.
Can we revive the
the reference, you're referring to reference electrode? If you treat it properly, there's no need to recover it. Okay?
No, sir. Once we know that now there is deviations in the reading, we already know that some portion is damaged.
Oh, in that case, you cannot do anything. You just have to say, I'm sorry, it happened, and to throw it away and to buy another one. So that's why, because these are very expensive, I am saying that you have to treat them properly. Okay? Okay? These kind of electrodes are pretty expensive. You know, a pH electrode, I think, today can cost a combined electrode, okay? Okay, can cost at least $150. Okay, pretty expensive. Any other questions?
Sir, if the porous bath is clogged by AGCL that you told, if it is clogged, is there any method to remove
that? It's like that. Yes. I don't remember exactly, but each manufacturer has its own instructions for doing it. Okay. Sometimes they also supply special solutions that you usually you don't know exactly what they put there. You know. It's kept secret for some reasons, I don't understand, that you have to use when it happens, okay?
So is it aeration of the surface, is that one of
the methods? You can try it, yes, you can try it. You can try it, yeah. Any other questions? Okay, I want to go to another type of measurement. Just a moment. Yes. Does anybody of you know what is ORP? Can you say it? What is ORP? Potential. Right. Okay. ORP is oxidation reduction potential, And this is, do you use this for your purposes? You do? Do you use it for your purposes? This kind of measurement? Yeah. Okay. Or P, as it says here, it's, it comes from oxidation reduction potential. And this is, I would say, almost a standard potential today, mainly in the industry. Okay? We rarely use it in laboratories, but in the industry it is used widely. And the reason that we try to avoid using it in laboratories, especially in scientific laboratories, is that this is one of the most, I would say, arbitrary methods for measuring something. Okay? Why arbitrary? Because here what we do is we take a couple of electrodes, okay? We dip them in our solution and we get a reading. And according to this reading, okay, we measure potential, of course, okay? And we get something. According to this reading, we are supposed to know what is the situation of what is the status, more correctly, of this solution with respect to either being an oxidative solution or reductive solution, okay? And it is somehow calibrated. There is a there is a wide agreement between the engineers, especially. There's a scale that they refer to usually, and they tell you if I'm getting, let's say, minus 300 millivolts, okay? The solution that we have in the process is of reductive character, okay? If it's plus 600 millivolts, it's of oxidative character, okay? There is no, why I'm saying that this is arbitrary, because there is no, I would say, a thermodynamic background behind it, okay? Okay? And usually, you can see this, for instance, this device is an ORP electrode that is used in the industry. It is an electrochemical measurement. Why? Because, again, we have two electrodes, okay, that we dip in our solution, and we measure the potential difference that is being developed between them, okay? We even do not use here, we usually use, I'm sorry, we usually, here in this case, in these ORP electrodes, usually what we have is a reference electrode that should be robust, okay, very robust, because we dipped these electrodes in industrial solutions, which may contain many chemicals. Some of them are very aggressive, okay? So we have to have this electrode very robust. And the other electrode is a metallic electrode. Usually, it is made out of platinum, okay? It is made out of platinum, and we measure the potential difference that is being developed between the reference electrode and the platinum electrode. And as I said, there is a scale to which we can judge arbitrarily again whether this solution that we measure is an oxidative solution or a reductive solution. Okay, so this is the ORP measurement, right? Potentiostatic measurement, not galvanostatic. Any questions about it? You see, by the way, how robust here is the structure of this electrode or this cell more precisely, because this has to be installed in, I would say, in a line of a process. Okay? Any question? Okay, I think that this is more or less, no, very important. I'm sorry, I almost forgot about it. Does any one of you do conductivity measurements? We mentioned conductivity before, you know. Does anybody of you do? How do you do the conductivity measurements? Can you say it? How is it done? How you perform it? Those of you in the back, you don't take any part in the discussions that we have here. Does anybody of you do conductivity measurements? Yeah? How do you do it? You just have an electrode, you dip it in the solution, and you have a reading. How it is done? What do we use? What kind of electrodes do we use for this, this purpose? Conductivity measurements is being done both in the laboratory and in the industry. It's a very important measurement. Okay? Let me jump one slide. Today, for instance, we estimate the level of TDS, total dissolved solids, okay, by measuring conductivity. I emphasize, this is an estimation. It's not a precise measurement, okay? Conductivity, okay, of the solution into TDS. In one of the textbooks, I found that they claim that 1 microsiemens per centimeter equals to 0.75 TDS in ppm. Okay? Sometimes you would like to convert it in terms of, to express it more precisely, to express it in terms of sodium chloride concentration. Okay? So you have to convert it accordingly. In other textbooks, you will find that 1 microsiemens per centimeter equals 0.64 ppm of TDS. Okay? I think that today, this is the most widely used conversion number, okay? In some of the devices that you have, it is being converted automatically. You don't have even to calculate it, right? Okay? So let me go back, okay? So for this purpose, we have what we call the conductivity cells. Here on the back, you have, in this slide, you have two examples of laboratory conductivity cells that are made out of glass. There are many shapes, okay? And, but what is important in these conductivity cells is that the geometry should be fixed and well known. And the geometry, I mean that the distance, as well the distance between the electrodes and the surface area of these, each one of these two electrodes should be precisely known. Okay? Why? Because we measure, when we do the measurements, we measure the resistance or the conductance of the solution that we put between these two electrodes. we would like to convert it into specific resistance or specific conductance, okay, which is the reciprocate of the resistance, okay? Why we would like to know the specific conductance? Because the specific conductance or the specific resistance is the value of the resistance or conductance when it is normalized to the geometric structure of the cell, okay? So when you know it, it is independent of the structure of the cell, right? So for this purpose, when you take into account this expression for the resistivity that you measure, and I mentioned it already when we talked about the behavior of solutions, okay, we have the specific resistivity here, which and we have also the length, the distance between the electrodes and the surface area of each one of these electrodes, okay? Okay? The product of these two values, okay, makes the total resistance that we measure. Now, if you look at the conductivity cells that you have in the, your laboratory, it will be always marked with a letter which is called K, and you'll have a number on the side, okay? This is called the cell constant, okay? Which is actually the length, the distance between the electrodes divided by the surface area of the electrodes, okay? This constant in most of the conductivity devices that we have today, you can adjust the reading in such a way that you put the exact value of the cell constant, and the adjustment is being done automatically in the device, and the device gives you directly the specific conductivity of the solution. Right? Okay? So the calculation is done in the device when after you put the cell constant. But you have to do it, okay? You have to put the cell constant, otherwise you will get a reading that you don't know exactly what the meaning of is. So you have, we have for the lab, we have this kind of a cell, but we have also this kind of a cell that we that you dip in the solution. This is a flow cell, and this is a cell that we dip, okay, in the solution, and we measure. The two electrodes are usually made out of platinum that is coated with what we call platinum black. If you look at the electrodes, you will see that they are actually black, okay, in order to increase the surface area of the electrode for different purposes. I'm not going to dwell on this. But you have to remember that these are two platinum electrodes, okay? This is especially when we deal with laboratory conductivity cells. In the industry, they use different types of electrodes, okay? Sometimes they do use platinum electrodes, but not solid metallic platinum. This is always a platinum that is being coated in a very thin layer on titanium, okay? So it is not that expensive because the amount of platinum there is very small. And usually these are very robust electrodes that we install on the solution, on the line where the solution, the industrial solution flows in order to constantly monitor the conductivity, okay? Do you have any idea what kind of potentials we use in order to measure the conductivity between these two electrodes. How it is done in the device that you use in the laboratory or in the industry? When we measure conductivity, we usually measure current that is induced under the influence of a certain potential that we apply, right? Because conductivity is something that we can characterize just by inducing an electric current through the solution, right? Remember? Okay, flow of ions, which is actually current, okay, we can, by inducing it, we can measure the conductivity. Okay, because remember Ohm's law, okay? The voltage equals the resistance times the current, okay? So we have to apply a certain voltage in order to induce the current, which we measure. From this, we can calculate either the resistance or the conductivity, right? But my question was referred as, do we have to use what we call a direct current or an AC current, oscillating current, for this purpose? What? You think that we have to use direct current? Is there any other idea? Do you agree? Direct current? AC current. AC current is the correct answer. Why do you use AC current? Usually the voltage that we apply in order to induce the current has a frequency of it may change from one manufacturer to another, but as far as I know, with most of them, it is 1.4 kilohertz. Okay, it is done in order to avoid net electrochemical reactions on the electrodes. Okay, because AC current means that we alternate the polarity of the electrodes according to the frequency that we apply. Okay, in this sense, in one cycle, this electrode will serve as an anode, and this electrode will serve as a cathode. When we are in the next cycle, or the next half cycle more correctly, this one will serve as an anode and this one will serve as a cathode. So in this case, we avoid having net electrochemical reactions, okay, on the cell, okay, because otherwise the conductivity will not be the correct conductivity, because when you have a net electrochemical reaction, something is being added to the solution. Because of this, because in electrochemical reaction, remember, we have products, okay? And these products may be introduced in the solution, okay? If we use DC current, we'll have this kind of products, because on the anode, we'll have a certain electrochemical reaction, on the cathode, we have another electrochemical reaction, and both of them will supply unwanted components into the solution, okay? When we use AC current, we avoid these net reactions to occur in the solution adjacent to the electrodes, right? So that is why we use AC voltage in order to measure conductivity. Is that clear? This is a very important point. Okay? You don't have to worry about it because this, again, this is done internally by the device that we have. Okay? Okay, but you just have to know that this is the type of driving force that we are using for these kind of measurements. Okay? Any questions? Yes. Yeah, what about it? 35? Yes? Ah, you want to copy that? Ah, okay. No problem. Any questions about conductivity measurements? Again, this is an electrochemical measurement, okay? Excuse me?
L constant is always less than 1. L constant.
Yes.
Is always less than 1.
Or no, no, it's not always less than 1. That is why each one of these electrodes that you dip into the solution, okay, they are specifically marked with their own cell constant, okay? Because whatever you will do in the manufacturing point, there is no one conductivity cell that is exactly the same as the other one, okay? So each one of them has to be specifically calibrated for the cell constant, and it can be done in quite simple way, okay? Because we have standard solutions that we know exactly the specific conductivity of them, okay? We dip the electrode into these standard solutions and we measure the conductivity, which we can convert then to the cell constant. Okay.
But whenever I have measured this one and also I have calibrated that, then the cell probe's conductivity, this cell constant is showing like 1.07. Then which one is maybe the correct?
I'm sorry to tell you, but the way that you work, okay, is totally improper, okay? Because you are not going to measure. In your measurements, you are not going to determine the cell constant. The cell constant is there. You have to plug in the cell constant into your device. Okay?
Whenever I have plugged in the cell constant in my device, then the known conductivity is not showing. That is showing fluctuations are coming in that
pattern. Okay, so in this case, I cannot give you an answer. So maybe something is wrong with your device. I don't know. Okay, so we'll have to check it. But again, the cell constant is given by the manufacturer and you cannot, you don't have any control on it, okay? This has to be plugged into your device, which then, based on this, will calculate the exact specific conductivity. Okay? Right? So check your device. Maybe something is wrong. By the way, you have to be careful by measuring, especially with these electrodes that you dip into the solution, that no air bubble will be trapped on the top side, okay? Because when you have it, then you may have interference with the measurements, okay? But today, usually, you see this tiny hole in the top, okay? It is there in order for the air bubble to to fade away. Okay? But you have to be sure that there's no air bubbles trapped in the upper part of the cell. Okay, this may be the reason for that you have interruptions. Any other questions? Okay, if not, we actually, by this, we finished the discussion. We finished the discussion of this chapter, and Deepak, it's I guess it's about time to finish, no? We have another 10 minutes.
I have a small announcement for them.
Yeah, okay, please. In the afternoon, we will discuss the issue of electrochemical reactors. Okay?